Hello students, welcome to the history class of Arvind Academy. In today's class, we study about Buddhism and Jainism. In 6th century BCE, many religious sects arose in middle Gangetic plain. Buddhist text, you said nearly 62 sects were there in 6th century BCE. And Jainism text says more than 300 religious sects were there in 6th century BCE. This shows there was some kind of social unrest in the post-Vedic society. Because of this social unrest, new kind of ideas emerged. So first we see what are the factors for emergence of new religious ideas. The first major factor was Varna system. Vedic societies, especially later Vedic society, was divided into four varnas. This is also called Chaturvarna system. In this, Brahmanas and Kshatriyas were given higher status, Vaishyas and Sudras were given lower status. In 6th century BCE, with advent of iron technology, agricultural practices were enhanced. Because of agricultural practices, the wealth is generated. The surplus in agriculture led to trading activities. This created more wealth in society. Vaishyas, the word Vaishya comes from Vish. Vaishya, the word comes from Vish. Vish means common people. These people used to involve in agriculture activities, trading activities, and other industrial activity like artisanship. So these people wanted to improve their status, but Varna system has given lower status. So they wanted to improve their status and they questioned the privileges of Brahmanas and Kshatriyas. It's not only about Vaishyas who questioned the authority of Brahmanas, but Kshatriyas also questioned the authority of Brahmanas. And if you observe Buddhism and Jainism, the founders of Buddhism and Jainism both comes from Kshatriya community. Buddha belonged to Sakya clan and Vardhamana Mahavira belonged to Gnetrika clan. So it was a kind of revolt against the Brahmanical domination. Because Vaishyas were paying taxes with hard work, whereas Brahmanas were enjoying the higher status in society. So this was a kind of revolutionary idea which questioned the privileges in the society. So Varna system was the major factor. Another factor was violence. Growing violence in society was another major factor. So here we are studying about factors for rise of new religious ideas. Second factor was violence. As we have understood, in 6th century BCE, it was the age of second urbanization. Second urbanization means wealth increased in society due to improved agricultural activities. Iron technology enabled agriculture to produce more, and this surplus has created wealth in the society. Whereas this agriculture required cattle. Cattle are very important for agricultural activities, whereas Vedic religion was encouraging cattle sacrifices. So this was a kind of protest against the violence prevailed in the Brahmanical society. So people wanted to protect the cattle wealth. And another factor was wars, continuous wars between states. 6th century BCE is the age of Mahajanapadas. We have seen so many kingdoms were there and these kingdoms used to fight amongst each other for expanding their territory. Because of continuous wars, trading activity got disturbed. So the traders and industry, those people who involved in industrial activities wanted peace in the society. So Majorly, Buddhism and Jainism, they condemned this violence and they propagated non-violence. So non-violence has become the core principle of Buddhism and Jainism and many other sects. So this is another factor for emergence of new religious ideas. One more factor was investment. As we have seen, wealth generated. Now the wealthy people wanted to invest their wealth in the economic system, whereas the Brahminical religion is condemning the lending practice. So it was considered as a sinful act because lending activity involves interest. So this Brahminical religion condemned taking interest on lending. So these wealthy people wanted to find a new kind of religious ideas or new philosophy in the society so that they can invest their wealth freely and they can gain the returns from the economic activities. So lending activity was considered as a sinful act in Brahminical religion, and they wanted, those people who have money wanted new religious ideas which promote lending activity. So Jainism was more popular in trading community. Buddhism also encouraged lending activities. Another factor was inequalities in the society. Due to growth of wealth in society, there was intense inequality prevailed in society. Some people lost in this life. This materialistic life did not create interest in some of the people. So they retired to forest and they became sannyasin. They wanted to lead a simple life. If you see the life of Buddha, Buddha was a king, about to become a king, he was a prince, and his father ensured all kind of facilities and all kinds of comforts so that Buddha will stay at home by enjoying this materialistic life. But finally, Buddha renounced this materialistic life and he became sannyasin. And after enlightenment, whatever the insights he got, he preached to the people, and those preachings and those teachings have become tenets of Buddhism. So because of growing inequalities, so people lost their life and they took sannyasi. They became sannyasin and they retired to forest and led a simple life. And whenever these kind of new ideas emerged, more people showed interest in these kind of new religious ideas and philosophies. So these are four major factors for the rise of new religious ideas. So as we have seen, nearly 62 sects were there according to Buddhist texts. According to Jaina text, more than 300 religious sects were there in society. But among them, Buddhism and Jainism became very popular. So these are factors for rise of new ideas. After knowing the factors for rise of new ideas, let us start with Buddhism. In Buddhism, we broadly see the life of Buddha and the people who are directly related to Buddha and his teachings. Later, we see the rulers who patronized Buddhism and the kind of literature developed based on Buddhist philosophy are the major aspects which we have to discuss in Buddhism. Now we will start with the people who are directly related to Buddha. These are factual information, so you have to remember for the examination, because in examination these facts are often asked. So let's start with mother name of the family life of Buddha. We are seeing here mother. Mother name of Buddha was Mahamaya, and father was Suddhodana, and Buddha wife's name was Yashodhara. And they got a son named Rahula. We have to remember these facts. mother name, father name, wife's name and son name. Here let us compare with Mahavira also, so that this table will be remembered easily. Mahavira. Mahavira's mother's name was Trishala. Father name Siddhartha. Wife's name Yashoda. He do not have son. He has a daughter. Buddha did not have daughter. Mahavira's daughter name Priya Darshini. So this is the family life of Buddha and Mahavira. You remember this table. And here one more, some important and confusing aspect is Buddha's original name was Siddhartha. When he was born, he was named as Siddharth. You should not confuse with Mahavira's father's name is also Siddhartha. Buddha's original name also Siddhartha. One more name for Buddha was Gautama. One more name for Buddha was Gautama. How he got his name? Within a week after Buddha's birth, his mother Mahamaya died. After this incident, his maternal aunt Prajapati Gautami raised him. Based on her name, Prajapati Gautami, he also got his name Gautama. After enlightenment, he was called Buddha. That's why he got Siddhartha, Gautama, Buddha. Continuously, if we have to remember these three names, continuously Siddhartha, Gautama, Buddha. So please remember, here the word, the names you may get confusion. And also wife's names. When question is asked about these people, we may get confusion whether it is related to Buddhism or Jainism. Same is the case with the places as well. Now we will see the places. The birthplace of Buddha and Mahavira. Lumbini. Mahavira's birthplace is Kundagrama. And where he got enlightenment. Bodhgaya. Here Jimbika Grama. And first sermon he gave in Saranath. And here we do not have information. And where he died. Here Kushinagara. He died in Pava. Again here also Kundagrama, Kushinagara. These two places often give confusion to the student. Kushinagar is the Nirvana place of Buddha. Kundagrama was the name of birthplace of Mahavira. So we have to remember this factual information, and in examination any kind of question can come from these two aspects. One is about people who are directly related to these people, Buddha and Mahavira, and also the places. Now we will see these places along with the rulers. We are here mainly discussing about Buddhism. So Jainism we will discuss later. But to compare Mahavira's life and Buddha's life, we have here given the list of people and list of places. Now we will see the map of Mahajanapadas. This is the map of Mahajanapadas. We are here in 6th century BCE. Where Buddha and Mahavira were born and they taught to the society. Now we will see their places. The main area of Buddha and Jaina. This is the place. Eastern Gangetic Plain. Now if we enlarge them. Sakya. Sakya is the place where Buddha was born. And Vaishali, this is the location where Mahavira was born. And Kushinagara, this is the place where Buddha died. So birthplace, death place. And Rajagriha, this is the place both associated with Buddha, associated with both Buddha and Mahavira. Near Rajagriha, Buddha got enlightenment near Rajagriha, the name is Bodhgaya. Mahavira died near Pava, that is also near Rajagriha. Varanasi, it is the location. Saranath is near Varanasi. So this is the location where Buddha has given his first sermon after enlightenment. Hence, this is the area where Buddha and Mahavira life revolves. And we will see in the larger picture along with rulers who were the contemporaries of Buddha and who promoted in what time. Let us take here kingdoms. For example, Sakya, Malla, Varji, Magadha. So in sequence, let's take. This is Sakya, or this one, the name of kingdom. The name of the kingdom was Kapilavastu. Kapilavastu. Next, Malla, another kingdom's name. Next, Vajji Confederacy. Here, Magadha. Magadha. Next, nearby Kashi. In between, we see Kosala. So these are various kingdoms. So we have just taken Kosala, Kasi, Malla, Vajji, Magadha and Sakya. We have taken here. Now these are the locations which are directly related to Buddha. Here, this is the birthplace. Lumbini is located in Kapilavastu kingdom. And regarding these places also, examiner can ask a question. Directly in IAS exam, a question was asked, which of the following kingdoms are related to Buddha? That is why we are discussing about these Mahajanapadas and the places associated with Buddha. Kapilavastu is the, it is a republic. Now we will see this. This is a republic. Malla was a republic. Vajji also a republic. Whereas Kosala, Kashi, Magadha are monarchies. So republic, another term. Republics, monarchies. Here single ruler. Here multiple people. Multiple kings come together and elect one single king to rule entire clan. So Kapilavastu is the republic, birthplace of Buddha, and he traveled to Magadha, Lumbini. He traveled to Magadha where he got enlightenment. Rajagriha. Near Rajagriha, Bodhgaya. Where he got enlightenment. So he got enlightenment in both there. Now he moved to Saranath, where he has given first sermon. Saranath. So birthplace, enlightenment place, and first sermon place. Later he moved to Kosala. He has given so many sermons. That's why he was also called Kosalan here. Buddha has got another name called Kosalan because he has given so many sermons, preachings in Kosala kingdom. Finally, he moved to Malla, where he died. That is also called Nirvana. In Buddhist terms, the incident related to death was called Nirvana. This is Kushinagara. So here you remember Kapilavastu, birthplace, Magadha, enlightenment place, Kashi, sermon, first sermon, so many sermons he has given in Kosala, Kosalan, and Malla is the republic where he died, attained Nirvana. So these are the places. Now we will see some of the important rulers in these kingdoms and their contemporaries. Here, Bimbisara. In Magadha, Bimbisara, he was the first great ruler of Magadha who expanded, we have seen in Magadha Mahajanapadas, who expanded his territory towards Anga and Kashi, and he has with marriage relations with Kosala also and Vajji Confederacy also. The second ruler, contemporary of Buddha, was Ajatashatru. He was another important ruler of Magadha. So both patronaged Buddha. And Kosala, Prasenajit. Prasenajit. He was the ruler of Kosala. This is about 500s to 400 BC. And after some point of time, Magadha was ruled by Shishunagas. One person named called, one king called Ashoka. He was famous in Buddhism because he conducted, convened second Buddhist council. He was the ruler of Magadha. And after Kala Ashoka, after some generations, Ashoka comes. He was also the ruler of Magadha. He convened second Buddhist council. Here Ajatashatru convened first Buddhist council, Kala Ashoka convened second Buddhist council, third Buddhist council was convened by Ashoka. And after some centuries, Kanishka will come. Kanishka convened fourth Buddhist council. So here you have to remember different Mahajanapadas and kingdoms, and who are some important rulers of Magadha kingdom, and those who convened Buddhist councils. Ajatashatru, first Buddhist council, Kala Ashoka, second Buddhist council, third Ashoka, third Buddhist council, Kala Ashoka, second Buddhist council, Ashoka, third Buddhist council. All these three people belong to Magadha. That shows the importance of Magadha kingdom has given to Buddhism. You remember these kingdoms. Now we will move to who are different disciples of Buddha and their literature. Disciples. Before going for disciples, let's see what Buddha has preached. Why Buddha has got so much acceptance in society? Buddha has given four noble truths. They were also called Arya Satyas. Do not get confused with Arya with Aryans. Arya was a general term. The meaning of Arya was noble. Hence, four noble truths. So in their time, these four noble truths were called four Arya Satyas. So that's why do not get confused with Aryan Vedic civilization, Vedic people or Aryan people. Arya was a language term. It's a language term. In language, it is called noble. Now we'll see what are the four noble truths. First, he said, entire world is full of sufferings. That is one truth. Truth is, world is full of sufferings. We have to accept this truth. Second one is, what are the reasons for these sufferings? Desires. There is no end for desires. Continuous desires in a personality or people are the causes for sufferings. This is another truth. People have to accept it. And third one, he said, these sufferings can be removed, can be eliminated. But how? By following a path. He suggested a path. If you follow the path of Buddha, you can eliminate suffering. So these are four noble truths. Now we'll see what is the path given by Buddha. That path is called Eightfold Path. The path given by Buddha was called Eightfold Path. The first one is this Eightfold Path contain, again we broadly divided into three components. The first component is moral component. Moral component means some of the prescriptions he has given related to moral conduct. Second one is related to meditation. Or we can say concentration. Third one related to wisdom. One, two, three. In moral component, we'll list out three major aspects. This Eightfold Path contains, first one is, he said, truth. Truth. So he said, right speech. Always tell the truth. If you tell the truth, it is one of the important component of reaching enlightenment. Second one is non-violence. This is right action. And third one is simple life. That is right livelihood. It is about sustainable life. Today we are calling new concept like sustainable development, where earth do not have sufficient resources. That's why we human beings should not exploit more the resource of the earth. If we follow this path, this is called sustainable development. So Buddha has said that simple life, right livelihood. So sustainable life, livelihood. So truth, right speech, right action, right livelihood. So these are related to the moral component. This is related to moral conduct of people. If we follow this moral conduct, it will give a path to enlightenment and we can remove the sufferings. Then concentration component is related to, under this again three will come. Fourth we can say, he said, right mindfulness, or before that control, restrain your senses. Restrain senses. For that, write concentration, mindfulness. To achieve mindfulness, one has to meditate. So in this, he said, right effort. Right effort is required to control the senses, to restrain the senses, so that desires can be limited, because desires are the causes for sufferings. So we can control the desires. For that, we have to remember the rules of the order. That is possible only if people are alert. So right mindfulness. So right mindfulness, alert, right awareness. Always be alert to the orders of the Sangha, so that you can control your desires and you can attain the enlightenment. And do meditate. This is right meditation. This is to enhance your concentration, to restrain your senses, and to improve your awareness. And in the wisdom part, two more components will come. This one, right vision. Another one is, in this vision, he said, entire world is full of sufferings. You have to accept this. To go for this, you should have right resolve. For this, you have to renounce this material world. So right vision is, this world is full of sufferings. That vision you should have. And if you resolve that renouncing this materialistic life will give a path to enlightenment, and finally you will come out of this birth and death cycle. So in this vision is wisdom related, so knowledge and wisdom. So here it talks about death, birth and death cycle. The law of karma continuously revolves birth and death, and after death again birth. So it is a karma cycle. So it is possible, you can break this by having right resolve. But right resolve means renouncing this material world and living a simple life. So again, this wisdom component comes to moral component, again concentration component, and wisdom component. So these are eight different aspects of Eightfold Path. So according to Buddha, if we follow this path, we can eliminate the desires, and by controlling the desires, we can eliminate the suffering. So this is the path. So during these, he almost preached 45 years. Let's see some of his disciples. So based on this philosophy, new kind of literature developed for the first time in Buddhism. This literature was developed by the disciples of Buddha, initial disciples of Buddha. Now let us see their literature and who are these people. Buddha, he got attainment. At the age of 29, he left his home. He meditated for almost 6 years. At the age of 35, he got enlightenment, and he preached till 80 years. That means he lived till 80. So 563 to 483 is generally accepted lifetime of Buddha. This is the generally accepted lifetime of Buddha, 563 BC to 483 BC. So within this period, he has given so many discourses. He has given so many orders or rules, Vinaya, for the disciples. So after his death, what happened? Some of his disciples like Ananda, Mahakashyapa, Upali. These three important disciples, these names are important for examination. So please remember, Ananda, Mahakashyapa, Upali. These are some of the important disciples. And these disciples propagated Buddhist ideas to the future generation. How they propagated the future to the future generations, now we will see that. You remember Ananda, Mahakashyapa and Upali. Buddhist councils were convened, and in these meetings, whatever the discourses and the teachings of Buddha, they were recorded. So after these recordings, these ideas were propagated to the future generation. The first Buddhist council was held in 483. Immediately after Buddha's death, first Buddhist council was held. Here, Mahakashyapa, we have seen one of the disciples of Buddha, Mahakashyapa, was the president of this assembly. Under his leadership, he presided the meeting. Under his leadership, first Buddhist council was held. And the ruler who convened this meeting was Ajatashatru. We have seen the rulers who are the contemporaries of Buddha. So Ajatashatru was contemporary of Buddha, and he convened first Buddhist council. The second Buddhist council was held in 383, after 100 years. Here, Sabakami was another important personality in Buddhism. He presided the meeting, and this was conducted by Kalashoka. He was from Shishunaga dynasty. Ajatashatru was from Haryanka dynasty. In Mahajanapadas, while teaching Mahajanapadas, we have learned about Haryanka dynasty, Shishunaga dynasty, how they enhanced Magadhan empire. Now, third Buddhist council was held in 250 BC. Here, Mogaliputta Tissa. He presided the meeting, and it was held by Ashoka, the great Magadhan emperor Ashoka. He propagated the Buddhist ideals to the world. And the fourth one, we do not know exactly the date of fourth Buddhist council, but it is 1st century AD. It was held under presidentship of Vasumitra, convened by Kanishka. He related to Kushana. He belonged to Kushanas, and Ashoka belongs to Mauryas. So here you have to remember the rulers who convened which Buddhist council. First Buddhist council, second Buddhist council, third and fourth. In these councils, some of the developments took place. Let's start. What is that? In first Buddhist council, it is immediately after Buddha's death. So 483 BC. Here what happened? Buddha has taught his preachings only through oral tradition. There was no writing at that point of time. Whatever Buddha was teaching, his students were listening. So immediately after death of Buddha, what happens to that knowledge which Buddha has given to the world? It was preserved in the minds of disciples. That's why I have emphasized importance to the disciples, important disciples like Ananda, Upali, Mahakashyapa. These were the people, enlightened people. These were having great memory power. Immediately after his death, they have created two important texts. One is Sutta Pitaka. Another one was Vinaya Pitaka. So immediately after Buddha's death, it has come from the mind of Ananda. Vinaya Pitaka has come from the mind of Upali. Upali, whatever he listened from Buddha's words, he has given his wisdom in the form of Vinaya Pitaka. And Ananda has given whatever words given by Buddha in the form of Sutta Pitaka. This happened in the first Buddhist council. It was held in Pataliputra. It was held in Rajgir. Rajgir was the capital of Magadha at that point of time. Ajatashatru was the king. Rajgir was the capital. So, what is the development during first Buddhist council? Development of Sutta Pitaka and Vinaya Pitaka. Now, second, 383 BC. Here, major important development was split in the Buddhist Sangha. Here, split. Already 100 years happened. So, always some new kinds of society would have changed. According to the changes, people might expect changes in the teachings and order of Sangha as well. So there naturally there was a conflict among the followers of Buddhism, and it led to the split. The first split in Buddhism. The first split, two split, one is Mahasanghika. Another one was Theravada or Stavira-vada. Stavira-vada or Theravada is also called teachings of elders. So in this Buddhist council, what happened? Some people questioned the relevance of Buddha's teaching in 383, because Buddha was born in 463, almost 200 years past. Under whose, which circumstances Buddha preached the world. So these people have questioned after 200 years of Buddha. So they kind of needed some kind of amendment to the teachings. Some accepted, some did not accept. So this led to the creation of a split. So one section was called Mahasanghikas, another section was called Theravada or Stavira-vada. And this kind of tradition continued in Buddhism. For every now and then, some kind of split used to come. Within Mahasanghika, some people again did split. In Theravada, again did split. So similar, so many different sections have come within Buddhism itself. So those we call sects, Buddhist sects. So this was continuing till next 200, 300 years. Now, the third Buddhist council, 250 BC, when Ashoka came, he wanted to remove the differences and he wanted to unify entire Sangha. Even though he tried, and in this, he tried to codify the philosophical aspects of Buddhism. Here in the first, because of this idea, the third Pitaka, Abhidhamma Pitaka, has come. Here you have to remember Sutta Pitaka, Vinaya Pitaka, Abhidhamma Pitaka. Three important Pitakas. This is called sacred books. These three are called sacred books of Buddhism. Sacred books of Buddhism, also called Pali Canon. Sacred books of Buddhism, Pali Canon. Sutta Pitaka, Vinaya Pitaka, Abhidhamma Pitaka. This is the history. They did not develop all of a sudden. After Buddha's death, all his teachings were stored in the memory of Ananda. Ananda has given Sutta Pitaka. Upali, the disciple of Buddha, Upali has given Vinaya Pitaka. And after Ashoka, when there were so many differences within Buddhist Sangha, he tried to give a kind of philosophical book for all kinds of Buddhists. And this led to creation of Abhidhamma Pitaka. This is the related to philosophical aspects of Buddhism. Sutta Pitaka means whatever Buddha's direct teachings, whatever Buddha taught, Ananda remembered. That's why Ananda was regarded because of his memory. he remembered most of the teachings of Buddha, and all his teachings were codified in Sutta Pitaka. And Upali, this is monastic order, monastic discipline. So he has given the discipline, what kind of conduct monks should follow during ascetic life. That is Vinaya Pitaka. Here this is philosophical aspect. And in the same Buddhist council, Ashoka decided to propagate this Buddhist ideals to the world. So the kind of missionary zeal has come in 250 BC under Ashoka. Next, third one. After third, fourth one has come in 1st century AD under Kanishka. Here what happened, already almost 400 years elapsed after Buddha's death. Now, so many changes have come in Buddhism. And so many social changes also emerged in the society. By this time, almost 18 sects. 18 sects have come in Buddhism. So different in different locations, in Andhra, some kind of and deep south, in western India, in central India, in northwestern part, Buddhism has spread. But according to the geographical locations, the new kind of tenets also emerged. So because of this new kind of geographical aspect, 18 sects emerged by 1st century AD. In Kundalwan, Kanishka convened 4th Buddhist Council. Under his leadership, all these 18 sects came together and they created majorly two sects. One was Mahayana. Second one was Hinayana. All these 18 sects grouped together into two different. These are the main sectarians of Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism and Hinayana Buddhism. Hinayana Buddhism means this is related to Theravada. In the first time when the split took place, this Theravada and related sects grouped under Hinayana, Mahasangika and related sects related to the formed towards Mahayana Buddhism. Some other like Lokottaravadin, Chaitika, Sarvastavadi, like that. Under Theravada, Staviravada, some more aspects like Mula Staviravada, Theravada. So these kind of sects grouped under Hinayana. This led to Hinayana, this led to Mahayana. So Mahayana, Buddha was, ideal worship was, here only symbols. In Hinayana, Buddha was not worshipped as a form of human being. He was worshipped in the form of symbols. In Mahayana Buddhism, he was worshipped as a god. So these are main differences between Mahayana and Hinayana. This is how, after death of Buddha, how Buddhism spread into different areas and how different kinds of tenets and literature emerged. And after reaching Sri Lanka, in Sri Lanka again new kind of literature developed like Mahavamsa, Deepavamsa. And also there were so many Buddhist literature like Nagarjuna, Nagasena, and different people have contributed towards Buddhist literature. Here we have seen symbols. What are these symbols? Now we'll see some of the important symbols related to Buddhism. The first one is, symbols means his birth is celebrated with the symbol of lotus. Second, his renunciation. The time when he left his home and became a sannyasin, that incident was called Mahabhinishkraman. Mahabhinishkraman. Mahabhinishkramana. So this was symbolized with a horse. Why horse? He took his horse and he left his home. That's why horse has become a symbol of Mahabhinishkramana. Then third one is enlightenment. His enlightenment is represented with peepal tree. because under peepal tree he got enlightenment. He meditated under peepal tree, so peepal tree has become symbol of Buddhism. Next, his first sermon. Not only first sermon, his sermons. First sermon was called Dharma Chakra Pravartana, and his sermons used, that first sermon used to be celebrated in the form of wheel. A wheel with 8 spokes. Why 8 spokes? Because of eightfold path. He prescribed eightfold path to remove sufferings. Hence, sermon was symbolized with a wheel with 8 spokes. Then finally, his death called Nirvana. It was symbolized with stupa. Stupa is a kind of mound, or it's a death place where Buddha's remnants, his skeletons or bones, have brought, and under he they buried these remnants, and on top of it stupa was built. That's why stupa was symbol of Nirvana. So these are important symbols. These symbols are very important with respect to the culture of India. Because if you see the Borhut stupas, for example, stupas like Sanchi stupa, Borhut stupa, Ajanta caves, Ellora caves, Amaravati, in architectures, cave architectures, these symbols played a dominant role. So they used to celebrate with these symbols. Even Ashoka pillars containing the symbols like lotus, horse, wheel. Well, you forget about this. Our national emblem. What is our national emblem with the 4 lines? It was taken from Ashoka pillar only. If you closely observe it, it will have horse. It is having the original pillar contains lotus, but our national symbol do not contain this inverted lotus. So this was also part of original pillar. From there, national emblem was taken. So lotus you will observe, horse you will observe, and wheel also is observed. So in our culture, it has become, these symbols have become part and parcel of India's culture. So wherever Buddhist or cave architecture, art and architecture comes, these symbols played a dominant role. So we have to remember all these things. These are so many facts do come in Buddhism, but Buddhism is an important chapter in examination point of view. That's why it was dealt in detail. So this is about Buddhism. Next we will see about Jainism also. Now we see about Jainism. Who are the leaders in Jainism and what are the principles of Jainism? In Jainism, there is a tradition called Tirthankara. According to the Jainism, there were 24 Tirthankaras. The last Tirthankara was Vardhamana Mahavira. He was contemporary to Buddha. But 200 years before Buddhism, Jainism was there. The first Tirthankara was Rishabhadeva. He was symbolized with bull. The name Rishabha means bull. Then another important one, 23rd Tirthankara, he was called Parshvanatha. He was symbolized with snake. The 24th Tirthankara was Vardhaman Mahavira. He was symbolized with lion. So Vardhamana Mahavira was the contemporary of Buddha. He was symbolized with lion. But before Vardhamana Mahavira, already 23 Tirthankaras or teachers already preached what was called Jainism. Already these people have given some tenets, 4 tenets they have already given. The 5th one Vardhamana Mahavira added. Like Buddhism, we have seen truth, non-violence, moral component of Eightfold Path. So in from that Eightfold Path, the here also five principles, these are also similar to that, the conduct given by Buddha. But Jainism was much before Buddhism. So here truth, non-violence, simple life, that means no property, no stealing, do not expect the property of others, do not have desires for others' wealth. So that is the fourth principle. Vardhaman Mahavira, he added Brahmacharya. So according to Jainism, these are five principles for a moral life. And they prescribe the path to attain moksha. The path to attain moksha, if we follow three principles, those were called Triratnas. Any person can attain moksha. That is right faith, right knowledge, and right action. One should have right faith and right knowledge and right action. If they follow these three ratnas, anyone can attain moksha. So religiously, these are the major tenets of Jainism. When we compare with Buddhism, the tenets were almost similar. So Buddha was born in a kind of environment where already these kind of principles were there in society. So it was a gradual process. By 6th century AD, this kind of environment has given fertile ground for more religious sects. Apart from Buddhism and Jainism, there were other sects like Ajivika sect. Another Charvaka. These kind of already sannyasin kind of lifestyle was already there. These kind of traditions were called Shramana tradition. Shramana means sannyasin. Living a simple life. Do not worry about the material wealth. Whatever is required just to live, they take it and they live a simple life. And they used to preach to the people, whoever come to them. That's why by 6th century BC, already kind of iron technology has created wealth. The social circumstances, iron technology led to high productivity in agriculture, led to trade, led to wealth. And this led to immoral life. Immorality spreaded in the society. Stealing for others' wealth, lies, violence, cruelty. So these were some of the characteristics of the society in 6th century BC. Under these circumstances, leaders like Buddha, Vardhaman Mahavira, Ajivika sect was given by Makkali Goshala. Makkali Goshala. So these kind of leaders have given these principles to live a simple life so that a person need not to always have sufferings while living. And even in Brahmanical tradition also, Upanishads were there. Upanishads were part of Brahmanical tradition. This itself questioned their own Brahmanical ideas, like Brahmanas, Vedic literature, and the Vedic sacrifices. The Upanishads condemned Vedic sacrifices. So already religious reform movement started within Brahmanical movement. Apart from Upanishads, non-Brahmanical movements also started. So Brahmanical and Vedic, it was called Vedic So Vedic tradition, non-Vedic tradition. So these non-Vedic practices, Buddhism, Jainism, Ajivika, Charvaka, these philosophies were parallel to Vedic practices and Upanishads. So Upanishads were part of Vedic tradition and other were part of non-Vedic tradition. So these are various aspects of religions that developed during 6th century BCE. We have to remember some of these facts which are important, and these religious reforms were against the social evils that spread within the society, and that we have seen what are the factors for the rise of these new movements and important facts about Buddhism and Jainism. We have to remember some of the people and places and some of the principles of these religions. So this is new religious reform movements in 6th century BCE.